Numbers chapter 1 and verse 18. And they assembled all the congregation together on the first day of the second month, and they declared their pedigrees after their families by the house of their fathers, according to the number of the names from 20 years old and upward by their polls. Shalom, brothers and sisters. This is your brother, Hawayala. I want to give all glory and praises to our Heavenly Father, Yahweh, and we do so in the name of our Lord and Savior, Yahweh Shai. Grace and mercy be abound to the hopeful elect scattered throughout the four corners of the earth that are waiting on the second coming of our Lord and Savior, Yahweh Shai HaMashiach. Today, we're going into a lesson concerning the scattered children of Israel. And, you know, it's basically a topic that everybody talks about, but there is some discrepancies with what is being taught. A lot of times people are looking at what they believe is phenotype or as a way to say who is what, and then they're rejecting people that don't fit a particular phenotype. And then you got other people that are focused on maybe more of a geographical location for a belief of who is an Israelite, meaning you have people that believe if you're on this side of the world, you're an Israelite, but if you're on the other side of the world, you're not. And, you know, I'd call them Western Hemisphere Israelites. And then you got the Negro only or Black only Israelites, okay? Because you have a sector of people who only think in these type of ways, but don't consider the scattering of Israel. And also, you have a lot of people that don't believe in patrilineage, okay? So meaning they don't believe that it's the father's line that would determine, you know, the lineage or the pedigree of a person. Some people believe it's the mother's line, okay? So there's a whole bunch of confusion going on. So for those that understand what I just read, we understand that the pedigree of the families was done by the house of the fathers. That's why when you go into Numbers chapter 1, as you keep reading down, and I'm not going to read it all, but you could just see here in verse 20, it has, and of the children of Reuben, Israel's eldest son, by their generations, after their families, by the house of their fathers, according to the number of the names, by their polls, every male from 20 years old and upward, all that were able to go forth to war. And they did this for every tribe, 20 years old and upward, that were able to go to war. Okay? And this is what Moses did in the wilderness in Mount Sinai, instructed to him by the Most High, okay, to do. Now, this is why we have to understand is that the Most High changes not. How he sets things up, how the families were made, how the houses, the pedigrees were, has always been the same through the house of the fathers. There was no law in here saying that one couldn't look a different way and be discounted as an Israelite, okay? This is what is implemented in because of people having the modern concepts of race that were implemented in under, you know, pretty much the Renaissance era and, you know, the Enlightenment period, which is nothing but a period of darkness, which many of our people, we can't even talk to them without using some of these terms because that's the only terms that they understand, like Black, white, you know, Asian, so on and so forth, right? So this is, you know, right here is probably going to be one of the more shocking things for those that are probably in the Israelite community that have actually ran across this individual's content, okay? And I'm going to go ahead and read one more precept in Numbers chapter 2 just to, you know, give another witness. This is in Numbers chapter 2 and starting at verse 2. Every man of the children of Israel shall pitch by his own standard with the ensign of their father's house far off about the tabernacle of the congregation they shall pitch. Okay, so if you go down through chapter 2, they're arranging the different camps based on the tribes. Okay, and as you see here, that on the east side toward the rising of the sun shall they of the standard of the camp of Judah pitch throughout their armies, and Nashon the son of Amminadab shall be captain of the children of Judah. Okay, so I'm reading that for a reason because of this individual here, all right, by the man name of Jake Morfonios, okay, which more than likely is his authorship name, and he's actually was very instrumental in investigating a lot of the stuff that has been going on the last few years and has been very, very accurate. In fact, he's actually, you know, has predicted certain actions that would occur over the last few years based off of his intel that he has and his background, which, you know, I know, I believe his stepfather, not even his actual biological father, his stepfather, I believe, was involved in the intelligence agency, and he had established relationships with some of his stepfather's contacts before he died, and he's also heavily involved in investigative journalism as well. So this is actually one of the big people that are out there, and he's actually someone who has been very outspoken against certain actions that have been occurring, you know, globally or geopolitically, okay, not only domestically, okay, but internationally as well. And so another one of his pages, which is the main one, this is going to be Blackstone Intelligence, and he's actually had a hard time being able to keep his channel going at times because of the, you know, the censorship that goes on with, as you know, with speaking any level of truth or speaking out against the higher powers. And you can watch a lot of his videos. And one thing that anybody that has watched his videos over the years, he has a very, very strong disdain for oppression of any kind. He hates oppression. And he hates, you know, systematic white supremacy and racism. Isn't that interesting, right? He speaks heavily against it, okay? And that's the reason why we always say you don't know who you're talking to. Now, let's go ahead and get into this particular individual, okay? Now, I just so happened I don't know what made me do it. I think I saw something on Twitter. Then I searched something on Twitter, and somebody came up that I wasn't even expecting when I did this search, and it was Jake Morfonios. Now, let's see exactly what Jake Morfonios said on one of his Twitter posts, which I had not seen this before until tonight. Now, this is Jake Morfonios' post, okay, from years back. He said, here, I continue to research my family history to figure out where my Nigerian DNA comes from. It's only a small amount, but I feel the incorporeal, almost ghostly pull to investigate this ancestor further. I feel a strong kinship with that part of my ancestry for some reason. Very, very interesting. Remember that, you see, remember I've always told you, brothers, okay, that I've talked to, you know, over the years, you know, Telegram chat, over the phone, and in person, okay? That seed line has a heavy vibration. When you descend from a particular group of people, there's something that will draw you to that people, okay? Especially those that are deep thinkers. And he said that even though his Nigerian DNA is small, something compels him to search so strongly because he feels so strongly connected to the people that are from this part of the world. Okay? Now, I'm going to kind of have to go a little bit slow with this because a lot of people are not familiar with DNA and how it works. You know, I myself was a biology major at one point. I almost double majored in it. I ended up minoring in it. No cap, all facts. I don't gotta lie. So I deeply know how biology works. In fact, my favorite subject was genetics, okay? And so this particular topic is something that I understand better than maybe, you know, of course, most people in the Israelite community that will go into this subject, except for somebody who actually studied, you know, higher end genetics. And so, as you see here, we're going to go into his DNA because everybody would say, well, you know what, it's possible for everybody to be mixed with this, that, and the other. But the difference with this DNA that he's referring to is this DNA that he has is patrilineal, okay? meaning he is a direct paternal descendant of this man right here, who the ancestry.com has listed as E1B1A Lee Okoro, which Okoro is a common name among Igbo people. It's like having a name like Johnson or Smith. Okay, there's other names like Okoye, Okafor, Nandi. There's a lot of names that are, which you can say, more common or more obvious Igbo surnames. Okay, and Okoro is one of the most common as well. Okay, it's very common. So I don't know if the name Okoro is what he got, was that, but let me tell you why, how I think what may have happened, right? Another person who was of Igbo descent, meaning more recent as far as immigrated, okay, may have taken the DNA, this ancestry DNA, and because his last name was Okoro, they implemented Okoro on top of Lee, meaning that whoever this Okoro person is, there is a person that migrated, that more than likely migrated from Nigeria in the last 40 to 50 years, because that's when a lot of Nigerians were coming here, okay, including my parents, and they more than likely took this test, and they had their DNA, that they had their DNA match with Lee, who would have been their own relative on their father's side. Now, this so happens to be something that my brother took as well, and he also had the same type of matches. However, I don't have his results to speak on it, but I do know that it was 8 or 9 generations ago that our father's line had sons, or great-grandfather's line had descendants that were traded into slavery into America. That I do know. Okay, so that could be the reason why the name Okoro is popping up, because it matched with another man who has the same paternal lineage, who has the name, last name Okoro. So what ancestry.com did is they just put it in a parentheses. So more than likely what it is with Jake Morfonios is that he's a paternal descendant from a family in Nigeria that's of the Igbo tribe with the last name Okoro. So I hope that kind of makes sense, because remember that a lot of that our people, when they were brought here, they were given names. They didn't have they were not allowed to keep any surnames or names that they had over from the places in which they were taken to. They were given new names. If you can remember the movie Roots, with the scene where Kunta Kinte had his name beaten out of him and he was given the name Toby. So it cut him off from his connection back to, at least a step back across, you know, the Atlantic to where he was taken from. Okay, and then that would also, that lack of connection and understanding would also be passed down to his descendants after him, much like Jake Morfonios did not have that information as well. So as you see, that when E1B1A Lee Okoro was born in 1790, his father E1B1A was 20 and his mother unknown was 20. Okay, and mind you, a lot of people, they try and figure out how did the so-called black population go from 400,000 around this time to 4 million by the time the Civil War happened, right? Because they had breeding farms. There was a ban on importation of new slaves sometime in the early 19th century, would have been the early 1800s. And this is where the slave owners decided to create breeding farms to mass, you know, to increase the population of our people that were enslaved under them. And then they would sell those children to other slave owners around the country. And many of these breeding farms, the main ones were in Virginia. You can see this in the movie called, I believe Mandingo was one of the movies, I want to say, where they showed a scene of a breeding farm. Okay, So, and I highly recommend that if you haven't watched Roots, watch Roots. If you, another movie to watch is definitely Mandingo, okay? It's a very raw, and it has some, a little bit of satire to it too, but it's a very real deal, you know, movie, okay? And I think anybody who's an Israelite, these are movies that you have to, you know, you have to watch, you know, if you're kind of like historically not astute or confused, or you just want to have more information about our history, okay? Sometimes you need actual visual depictions to help you understand what it is our people went through, because if you don't, then you're going to be out here cooning like some of these people out here saying that, you know, racism doesn't exist for butter biscuit, okay? You're going to be like one of them, okay? You're going to be sounding like a lot of these so-called black pundits out here that are talking crazy. All right. So as you see here, he had two sons with a mulatto, slave folks. Okay. So this particular slave, more than likely folks was a last name. Now they'll actually spell it differently. And by the way, if this slave, this mulatto slave, if her last name was Folks, we know if she's mulatto that 99 times out of, like, you know, 100, her father would have been a, you know, a slave master. Her mother would have been an enslaved woman, and then she would have been born. She probably came from the Folks family, and therefore the Folks family, any sons that they would have, they would be descendants of the slave owner. But as far as for Mr. Jake Morfonios, his lineage was of the enslaved. Okay, he was a descendant of the children of the captivity on his father's side. Okay, now let's go ahead and go down and let's see what else he has to say. So he says, I have E1B1A haplogroup DNA. Now, by the way, you have what's called maternal DNA and paternal DNA. Paternal DNA, okay, or your haplogroup, what's known as your Y DNA, it goes from father to son. It's an unbroken chain from father to son. So anytime you a man, okay, begats a son, that son inherits their Y DNA. It's an unbroken chain of inheritance, okay? Now, these Y DNAs, like E1B1A, they have subgroups as well that are different from one another. So a lot of times a subgroup is really what's going to separate the person realistically. It's pretty complex if you don't, if you haven't studied it like I have. So it's not always a one size fits all. So because somebody E1B1A, they're of the same tribe and family. Okay, it's not like that. It's a lot more complex. And only people that have studied this can have these type of like conversations at the level of dealing with the subgroups, because it gets a lot more complex. And this is where a lot of confusion comes in with the Israelite community, where they do not take into consideration subgroups, because what happened is that the people that created the DNA grouping of haplogroups when it comes to Y DNA, they basically separated regions of the world and gave them their own haplogroups based off of regions largely, and then they created subgroups to determine which paternal lineage on the subgroup level was tied to who. This creates a lot of confusion, because what happens is the entire, almost the entire Africa is under the E haplogroup and doesn't take into consideration the subgroup. So you can understand that the people, that not everybody on the continent of Africa are related, okay? And it causes confusion because people look at E as meaning directly related to, when it doesn't. They're grouping it based off of certain biases that they already had in their racial categorization of people over the last 500 years. So, but for the sake of this, it doesn't matter in this regard, because he already knows that this particular Y DNA that he did inherit, going back to Mr. Lee, who was born in 1790, that lineage goes back to the Igbo people of Eastern Nigeria, also found, you know, throughout other parts of West Africa as well, and of course throughout the world. But that's a whole nother subject, right? So as we read here, he says, which originates from the Igbo people who today live around the tiny town of Bodo, Nigeria. 1.4 million Igbo were kidnapped and sold into slavery through the slave trading port at the Bight of Bonny. So as you see here, and I've actually, you know, very interestingly enough, I've actually sent this to certain brothers in the group chat, so you can understand. Now, this is the country of Nigeria. This is Cameroon. Okay, to give you an idea, Cameroon used to be part of Nigeria, at least this region right here. Okay, this region right here used to be part of Nigeria. It used to be an English-speaking part of the former British colony, but it was given over to the French. And that's how now in Cameroon, they speak both French and English. And there's an issue with that as well, because of the language differences of the people from that colonial period. Now, Francis Ngannou's from Cameroon, and then you have Joel Embiid. Those are like two people that I'm pretty sure some of you brothers are very familiar with. Francis Ngannou is the UFC fighter, and of course Joel Embiid is the NBA player from the 76ers, who's currently on the U.S. Olympic team out in Paris. Okay, just to kind of give you an idea how close these areas are. Now, when you look at the Igbo, in this light green area, that light green area is the area in which Igbos have indigenous roots in. Okay, so this whole area, I can't really say what the size of this area will be. The size of the area might be the size of maybe like a Louisiana or something like that. Okay, so this area is where Igbo people resided in, and this would have been the location and area in which Jake Mofonius's forefather would have been taken from and sold into slavery in this blue area, which is another tribe known as the Ijaw. They would have been the ones that would have been occupying at the time that particular port to trade with the British. Okay, and they would have been the ones that would have been raiding, capturing Igbo people and then selling them in this blue area, because the blue area is another tribe, the Ijaw tribe. Okay, and then this light green area, or this mid green, you could say mid green area, is where the Igbos are. You can see IGBO, and that's a whole nother story about the spelling of Igbo, which is one of the secret councils that have been had over the last, you know, century to try and remove information from the people that are looking to search for it. Now, so when you think about Nigeria and someone says they're from Nigeria, understand that all these different groups have their own indigenous territories, okay? It's not some kind of free-for-all like America where just people just can, you know, everybody can just move wherever and then you have a new identity. You don't really get a new identity when you're from an actual nation, a nation group, okay? When you're from if you're Yoruba, if you're from Benin and you're an Edo person, that's what you are. You can move to Lagos, you can move to Abuja. You're always going to be where your indigenous land is from. You can never change that. It's impossible, in fact, to even change it from a cultural perspective. And this is based off of ancient thinking, biblical age thinking, okay? So let's go ahead and go further down, okay? And we're gonna read what he has to say. So he says, my Igbo ancestors were kidnapped by fellow Africans, okay, meaning other nations, you see here. So you see, it's a distinction, man. It's a distinction. Okay, so remember, anybody on the continent of Africa is considered an African. Anybody in the continent of Europe is considered a European. Okay? But you have to break everything down based off of nation groups, nation and people groups. And then under nation people groups, you have tribes and ethnicities. Okay? Because you even have different clans among these different tribes as well. Okay, especially the bigger your group becomes, you begin to have different clans and factions that are still part of the same nation group, but they begin to split off into different clans and ethnic groups sometimes, or subgroups that still maintain the same identity. They just become more of a subgroup, and that's kind of more complex. If you want to give it a good idea, think Native American Indians and the different tribes that were among them, right? Sometimes some of the, like the Creek Indians might have had different clans, but they were all Creek Indians, right? Same thing with the Seminole Indians. So now, when you go on, it says that they were kidnapped by fellow Africans near Bodo and sold to British slavers, which basically what it was is this. They were kidnapped, okay, in battles, in basically incursions, okay, because what would happen is the Europeans would give the other groups, the Philistines and the Canaanites, okay, the Philistine and the Canaanite tribes, give them weapons, and they would go and raid these areas. They would either have battles. Remember, a lot of times they would have more superior weapons because they would get those from the Europeans in order to go in and be able to be more successful at their raiding, okay? And then sometimes they will use middlemen to do that, okay? And then they would actually sell them to the Europeans, okay? So that's exactly how it went. This idea that people were trading their own people, that is literally suicide. You're literally, if you're trading your own people, remember, all black people are not, also called black people are not all one biblical nation group. Okay. So there's no time in history where a group of people decided to en masse by the millions sell their own people into slavery. It's literally like committing a mass suicide by the millions upon your own self. That doesn't make any sense. Okay, but this is what they taught us in school. They don't teach you who kidnapped who and why and who and sold to who. Well, this is what it is, okay? See, you notice he didn't say my Igbo ancestors were kidnapped by fellow Igbos. He said fellow Africans, because these other African people were not from the same tribe and nation group as the Igbos. Now, they were sold near Bodo, which is basically the Bani area, okay, which is where they would have been sold out from, okay, which is a town, a port town, or near Bani, and sold to British slavers. They were transported on British vessels to work on sugar cane plantations in Barbados. Later, they were shipped to Virginia and down into the Carolinas, where my Lee family owned them. He put owned in quotation marks. Why? Because the Lee family is the one that owned E1B1A Okoro. Hence the reason why the name that was inherited by the males that descended from Okoro Lee, you know, was given to them. That's why that Lee name was given to them. Just like a lot of our people here, the surnames that many of our people have here and in the Caribbean and throughout the Americas was inherited, what they got and took from usually the slave owning family. Many also people just took on other names as well. This is very common with the last name Washington, where a lot of people that were freedmen or freed after slavery adopted the last name Washington to show camaraderie with the first president, George Washington. Okay? So now, and this is nothing new under the sun. This thing happened in the back in the day. We had a lot of our people actually take on the surname Alexander during the Greek Empire. Okay, like Tiberius Alexander, but he was a Jew. Okay, so and he has these little maps, because I believe they give them that information. Now this is where you kind of got messed up, okay, because you have some people that were promoting this stuff. I'm gonna just go ahead and read this part at the very bottom. It says the E1B1A haplogroup is believed by many to be a black Hebrew Israelite bloodline. I'm not familiar enough with the scientific reasoning behind that position to have an opinion on the legitimacy of this claim. People who know more are welcome to send me info. Now, I don't think anybody had sent him any info, but basically, as he was doing research, I guess, on the Igbo people, more than likely, he started coming across a lot of Israelite and Hebrew information on the Igbo people. And I'm pretty sure that people have, at least in the Israelite community that I've been studying, probably have already ran across a lot of that information as well. Okay, so I think that's really it on that one. So I think he had actual communication here, and as you see here, it says, I've been communicating with numerous people of this same Nigerian descent to figure out where the exact links are that connect us to our common ancestor. It appears that some of my slave owning ancestors interbred with slaves and or non-slave mulattoes. Okay, and by the way, non-slave mulattoes means that the non-slave mulattoes is basically mulattoes who were descendants of slave owners and slave women, and they became freed, because many times in these plantations, whenever the slave owner would have children with the slave woman, those slave owning children, those mulatto children that would come out, they would actually be considered free. They would not be, sometimes, a lot of times, they would not be working the field. They would maybe stay in the house with the rest of the family. Okay, now they'll have a second level class from the full-blooded white, you can say, and I'm using that term loosely, full-blooded white children, but a lot of times they'll be allowed to have certain privileges because they are the descendants of the slave master. Okay, now in some instances, the slave master, which it appears in this particular instance that his forefather, Jake Morfonius's forefather, Lee Okoro, we'll just call him Lee, his forefather Lee married an actual mulatto that was from the Folks family. Okay, so more than likely she was purchased from the Folks people's plantation, and then she was brought over and she was married off to Lee Okoro and had the two sons with her. Because sometimes they'll do that if they don't have enough, they'll do that for the sake of increasing the amount of slaves that they have. So they'll buy a female and then they'll give them off to the male in order for the male to then then have children with her, and then they'll sell off those children. So more than likely those two sons that were birthed, we don't know what happened with them, but there's a possibility that they might have just been sold to another plantation, or they might have been stayed within the Lee family. We don't know, however, right? He could probably find that out, whether or not those particular ones ended up in the same family, right? So now we're going to go ahead and read what was communicated with him and the people who were in this ancestry.com, and they're going to communicate with each other. So here is somebody, Darius Jones. Okay, ain't that, it don't sound like a, doesn't that sound like a black American name, Darius Jones, right? So he says, your tree showed up as a hint for one of my ancestors, Peter Lee, from 1805 to 1880. But I can't figure out how you're connected to Peter Lee. What is your connection? Now, it doesn't mean that Darius Jones, and this is why it's hard to explain DNA for those that haven't done, you know, studying on it. Darius Jones and Jake Morfonius are related to each other. However, it does not mean that they share the same paternal lineage. Okay? Because one thing with ancestry DNA tests, it pulls up anybody that has a similar ancestor as you. So even if it's on your maternal side, okay, or if it's on your if it's on one of your grandfathers, if it's your grandfather's mother's side, your great-great-great-grandfather's mother's side, it could pull up that your great-great-grandfather's mother's side is related to Mr. Jones. So it's not a streamline, Mr. Darius Jones and Mr. Jake Morfonius have the same paternal lineage. No, they just have a common ancestor, and that common ancestor happens to be Peter Lee, who was born in 1805 and died in 1880. which the very interesting thing about the 1880 is that that would mean that Mr. Peter Lee would have been on the 1870 census, which is the census that would tie back all freed people after war, after the Civil War. Okay, so he would actually be an instrumental part when it comes to lineage tracking, okay, because he would have been on that first census in 1870 after the Civil War, and then all his kids would have been under that as well. Okay, so it's actually makes for a very interesting connection. And then he would have to track the sons of Peter Lee all the way to him, which wouldn't take long. He actually can find it. I wouldn't be surprised if he already has that already now, to where he can literally branch everything out from everybody that's related to Peter Lee. And he can really, you know, put that stuff together. Probably by now, he probably already done so. So this is a very interesting thing that he found out. So now we're going to go into the second part. Like I told you, it was, you know, I'm going to have to, you know, break each part down. Okay, so because I'm assuming that some of y'all have never really looked into DNA. Okay, and it can be confusing to those who haven't. So here's another one saying, "Hi, Jake, my name is Benita Lee. I'm a family historian. I see you have my Lee ancestors connected to your tree. Is it possible that the Lee ancestors from your tree are the slaveholders of my Lee ancestors?" See, so she's assuming, I'm assuming she's a so-called black woman. Now, when she saw that she connected with Jake, and of course we see that Mr. Jake Morfonios is a white presenting man. He looks like this society in the world would consider a white man. So what she was under the assumption, she is under the assumption that Jake Morfonios' great-grandfather was the owner of her people. So you see how confusing that is when you think about phenotype, when you think that because somebody looks like certain thing, you assume something. So she's under the assumption that the Lee family, that he's from the Lee family that owned her people. I don't think if you're not understanding that, let me know in the comments if you're not understanding any part of this particular lesson, okay? But I think y'all get what I'm saying. She's assuming because he's so-called white that he has to be from the slave-owning lineage, if you get my drift. So as you read on, she says, "The first Lee ancestor I have found was my great-great-great grandfather Joseph Lee," which means that this woman Benita Lee is a direct descendant, okay, on her father's side, because this is clearly, her name is not a maternal name. She got this last name Lee from her father, meaning she's probably not married, or she maybe never legally changed her name if she did get married. So her paternal grandfather is Joseph Lee, okay, who was born in 1831, which it may be the son of Peter Lee, but we don't know, okay? Because it's possible that Peter Lee could be the father of Joseph Lee because of the age. Born in 1805, born in 1831. So it says, under the 1870 census record, it says Joseph's father was from Virginia, but Joseph was born in Edgefield, South Carolina, and that could be from breeding farms. Remember, if he was born in 1831, the breeding farms would have still been around prior to the Civil War kicking off. So it's possible he was born in South Carolina, okay, and he was sent off to Virginia to the plantation. Okay, that was happening a lot back then. It says, now look at another one. "No problem, Jake. Now if you find you've got connections between your North Carolina Lees and Williamson Norwood, 1777 to 1848 in South Carolina, who came down from North Carolina to Abbeville County, South Carolina, keep me in mind. From his will inventory, I determined that he had my ancestors during enslavement." Okay, so basically what they're determining is that this particular individual, Williamson Norwood, owned their ancestors at one point and enslaved them. Okay? Now, this is from Sonia. I'm assuming Sonia, I can't tell if this is a woman or man, so we don't know. But this is from a female by the name of Sonia who's writing this. All right, so I don't know where he got them from, and I hadn't figured out which of his descendants received which of my ancestors. Because like I said, they were selling them from breeding farms to plantations. Okay, from plantations to another plantation, especially after the woman gave birth to the children. So this was a lot of movement going on, and it's kind of tough to patch up, because what happens is that Mr. Lee Okoro, the original one that was born in 1790, his paternal lineage would actually, his descendants from his lineage would have multiple last names, because his lineage had multiple sons that came out of him that were sold to various plantations. And when they were freed, more than likely they took on the last names of the family's plantation in whom they were freed from in 1865. So if you didn't understand what I said, rewind it back, play it slow, and think about what I said. Okay. Now, I think beyond that, what he did is he started doing research on Igbo people and some of the things that happened in the different lands. And I think if he would understand, more, he'll probably have a better idea. But, you know, this is a very interesting thing. So I don't think there's any more information from this particular So somebody wrote to him that he may be related to George Foreman. I don't know if George Foreman is from the same family tree as him, but somebody saying he may be related to George Foreman, which is interesting. And by the way, you know, George Foreman, you know what I'm saying, from Houston. So here it says the reason you could be that you feel empathy with oppressed part of your family. It's normal to have emotions for weak and oppressed. You are a nice person, whoever your ancestors were. So see, the reason why he had empathy for the oppressed and the weak and the downtrodden, because he's an Israelite. That's right. See, everything is making sense for him, and his paternal lineage is putting a heavy vibration on him. See, the sons of Jacob got a heavy vibration, okay, that doesn't allow you to really deny oppression, man. And if you walk into wanting to be an oppressor or siding with the oppressor, you're making a deliberate, conscious effort to be a wicked person against your own people. Okay? That's the reason why the conscience of our those that do that is going to be condemned on the day of judgment. Those who stand with the oppressors. Okay? It's all making sense when you see a guy like Jake Morfonius. And I highly recommend, for those of y'all that have watched this lesson and have not seen any of Jake Morfonius's work, I highly recommend that you watch some of his stuff. So you can kind of get a good idea of how of his, will to fight oppression. Okay. At, you know, even to lose his own freedom fighting. Okay. So let's go ahead and go off to Luke chapter 21 and verse 24. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led away captive into all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down at the Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles be fulfilled. Now, one of the reasons why I read that is not only because of what we just went over as far as being captured and sold into slavery into the new world, but also because Jake Morfonius has a heavy insight and goes into the whole issue of the Israeli Gaza, Palestinian crisis, okay, which he has for years studied that. And he's actually done lessons where he's dug deep, finding out that the people that are in the land are not really descendants of the people that are whose land it's for, meaning the children of Israel, meaning he found out and he dig deep and did lessons showing that those people were not the real people. Now, I don't know if he knew this information about his own background at the time, but it's very obvious that he definitely doesn't feel some type of camaraderie with those people that are in the land. It's very obvious, and this has actually stunted his channel. He's actually received, you know, certain threats, you know, from, you know, the powers that be, and he's been kind of stifled in his ability to, you know, speak out more, okay? Which, interestingly enough, I think the Twitter platform is a very good place for someone to really just kind of be more free with their speech compared to, like, you know, YouTube. So I don't know if he's going to try and transition to using that more. We'll have to kind of wait and see. I don't know his current condition and situation as of right now, but time will tell. So now let's go ahead and go on to the book of Baruch. Okay, this is the book of Baruch, chapter 4. We'll start at verse, kind of get a little bit closer. So this is verse 4. O Israel, happy are we, for the things that are pleasing to God are made known unto us. Be of good cheer, my people, the memorial of Israel. Ye were sold to the nations, not for your destruction, but because ye moved God to wrath, ye were delivered unto your enemies. So when he went into the information, he realized that the Ebo people, who he is a descendant of through Lee Okoro, he realized that they were sold by their enemies, sold to the British. Okay, now we know why it happened, because they were going off, okay, and they broke the covenant of the Lord. And the covenant being broken leads to curses. That's what it says in verse 7. For ye provoked him that made you by sacrificing unto devils and not to God. Okay, they were in idolatry. Okay, that's why our people were going through it. Okay, and guess what? It don't stop because people think that the people that are across the ocean over in Africa are not oppressed or are not facing the oppression. If anybody who knows anything about Nigeria and knows anything about Igbo people knows that oppression has been heavy upon the Igbo people, to the point where even the people from other groups, from other tribal groups, you have some of them that are wondering, dang, why are they hated? They're asking this among themselves. They are freaking, some of them are perplexed. They scratching their head like, dang, they ain't doing nothing to people. They minding their business. They making their money. They taking care of their families. But they have all these people that hate them without a cause. And it's fascinating. It even fascinated many people that were in the, you know, political world back during the Nigerian Civil War. It baffled them. Okay? But that's because there's energies. Okay, when you're of the lineage, okay, of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, okay, you are enemy of all nations. Okay? Some people may like you, but there's always that undercurrent level of contempt that's going to go towards the nation of Israel. Okay? Verse 8. Ye have forgotten the everlasting God that brought you up, and ye have grieved Jerusalem that nursed you. For when she saw the wrath of God coming upon you, she said, hearken, O ye that dwell about Zion. Okay, Yahweh hath brought upon me great mourning, for I saw the captivity of my sons and daughters, which the everlasting brought unto them. With joy did I nourish them, but sent them away with weeping and mourning. Let no man rejoice over me, a widow and forsaken of many, who for the sins of my children am left desolate, because they departed from the laws of God. They knew not his statutes, nor walked in the ways of his commandments, nor trod in the paths of discipline in his righteousness. Let them that dwell about Zion come and remember ye the captivity of my sons and daughters, which the everlasting hath brought upon them. Okay? And so that's what we're doing. Okay? We are remembering. Okay? The Most High is remembering the covenant that he made with our fathers by putting these punishments upon us as a people, wherever we be. And we have to understand that the scattering of Israel is not about being black. It's not about being Hispanic. It's not about being a Native American. It's about being a descendant of Jacob. Okay? It's not about having how much melanin or how woolly your hair is. Okay? It's not about that. It's about your lineage, by the house of your fathers, by your poles, by your families, by your pedigree. And so that means that we have to be careful about how and who we're talking to you. Okay? Remember what the Most High told Samuel, that the Most High judged not by outward appearance like man do, but God judges the heart. Okay? And the heart of Jake Morfonios was one who stands for the weak and the oppressed, including the Israelites. So hopefully this is edifying. And again, I want to give all glory and praises to our Heavenly Father, Yahweh. And we do so in the name of our Lord and Savior, Yahweh Shai. Grace and mercy be balanced and hopeful that's scattered throughout the four corners of the earth. Shalom.